Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Dana Buckler Show. My name is Dana, and I am joined by my regular co-host on the 20th Century Movie Club, Michael Scott. How are you, sir?
I am well, Dana. How are you today?
I'm doing good. I think you and I have decided that we're going to branch out a little bit beyond the 20th Century Movie Club. However, by the title of this episode, it's clear we're staying firmly in the 20th century. We've decided that the time has come for you and I to do a breakdown of a very long-running franchise, one that I know is near and dear to your heart, near and dear to my heart, and near and dear to millions of people's hearts. So we are going to be talking about the Terminator franchise. In this episode, we're going to be discussing the Terminator. But before we do that, Mike, this entire franchise, everything is based on an idea by the legendary film director James Cameron. So I think it's apropos that before we even get into a discussion of the Terminator, that I ask you, what are your thoughts on James Cameron, the writer, and James Cameron, the director?
I'll be honest, I have complicated feelings about James Cameron. I definitely am not part of the cult of Cameron. I think he has, for me, two absolute masterpieces, two movies that I could watch over and over again, one of which we're going to talk about today. The other one is Aliens. And I tend to like his movies after that less than others. And I think part of the problem for that is because you broke them up. I think James Cameron, the director, is a technical master. He is one of the best we've ever had. I'm not trying to be like hyperbolic here, but I think James Cameron, the writer, is pretty poor. I don't think he's a very good writer. He in a lot of ways kind of reminds me, it's different, but it reminds me of J.J. Abrams in that Cameron is a really good idea man, but I don't think he's very good at the nuts and bolts and the nitty gritty and things like actual believable human characters and stuff like that. Although, you know, there's exceptions to every rule because we'll talk about, you know, we're about to talk about Terminator and all of these things I'm saying about Cameron aren't going to apply on, you know, what I'm going to say about Terminator. But I do think a lot of them apply when we get into Terminator 2. So he's not my favorite director, to be honest with you, in spite of the fact that he's made a couple of my absolute favorite movies of all time. I know you are a much bigger Cameron fan than I am.
Yeah, I am. He is. He's easily in my top, I might even say top three or top four directors out there. He is somebody that I can recall. The anticipation for me to see Avatar in 2009, it was unlike anything I can remember. Now, my experience with the movie may have been a little bit different. I will be the first to tell you that I'm not the biggest fan of that film, although I 100% respect what he accomplished in just, like you said, the technical side of the filmmaking process of that film. That being said, I adore The Terminator. Aliens is a masterpiece. The Abyss is such an underrated gem. Terminator 2, we'll get to that. I enjoy the hell out of True Lies, and the Titanic, I think, is, again, a masterpiece. And again, this is me. I'm gushing a little bit over Cameron already, but now something you said there about on a technical level. One of the things I love about Cameron is his attention to detail inside of the world that he creates, be it, you know, in the movie Aliens or The Abyss, everything feels lived in, everything feels tactile. I mean, and that attention to detail, I think, is so rare. And I've also always said that Cameron tends to get, I think, the best performances out of every single character on screen, whether that character has one line of dialogue or is the star of the film. I feel like he spends enough time with each character and explains what their particular role is, what their particular part is, what he hopes that they will accomplish from that scene. And I just think he's a master. And I echo what you said on a technical level. From the story writing, let's be honest, like, some of the plots of his films are very basic. I mean, he's not Christopher Nolan when it gets into the story side of things. So I will agree with you on that one. But he is easily next to Tarantino and next to, well, 90s and early 2000s Spielbergs. There's not another director that I will say that I'm going to run to the theater the second one of his movies comes out. Now, that could also be because the man only releases a movie once every 12 years, so you get that anticipation level really built up. But yeah, he's amongst my favorites.
Yeah, and I know that I'm a bit, and there's actually, as we're talking about this, and I hope everybody that's listened to the Movie Club knows, I'm not like a hot take guy, but as you and I have talked about, there's definitely some, you know, I'm going to have some opinions on some of these movies that the general populace doesn't agree with as much. And I kind of feel that way about Cameron. I mean, I know everybody loves Cameron. He's just, a lot of his movies have just kind of left me at a distance, which may be why the two that I love so much, because they just grab me and pull me in and don't let me go. I'm always amazed every time I watch Aliens, just how brilliantly tense that movie is. That is a masterclass in building tension. And I just, I love it. So, you know, it's not like I'm a Cameron hater by any means.
You know, one of the things he does, and I think as soon as you mention Aliens, one of the very things, first things that pops into my mind, it's not the incredible puppeteering of the alien queen at the end, or the use of incredible practical effects. You know, I've said numerous times, especially when, you know, when the movie was recommended on the 20th Century Movie Club, that movie release as is in 2020 would become a seminal classic all over again. I think it's a damn near perfect film. But immediately what I think of when you say Aliens is just how damn likable all the characters are in his movie. In that movie, and how damn likable most of the characters are in most of the films that he makes. I mean, when we talk about the Terminator, even we get just talk about the police officers and the detectives in the Terminator, like I just immediately think about just how likable and charismatic the characters are in his movies. What would you say to that?
I would say that's certainly true for most of his movies. I think, you know, and I share your opinion on Avatar. I think that's one where he kind of lets his characters down, and part of that is, I don't know that, you know, you mentioned he gets the best performances out of all of his actors. That's true, but I don't know that the best performance of sentient block of wood Sam Worthington is anything really to write home about. But I think especially in his earlier days, he really did make, even if they weren't likable, like, you know, I'm not sure that I really consider Bill Paxton in Aliens to be likable, but he's a character that you empathize with and enjoy seeing on screen. He's a fully fleshed out character. And I think in his early movies, he really does nail that. You know, and especially I think in Terminator, you'll hear me go on and on about how great I think Sarah Connor and Kyle Reese are in this movie. I think they're two of my favorite characters that have ever been in a movie, and they're played by, I just can't imagine anybody but Linda Hamilton and Michael Biehn playing them. They're so great.
So let me ask you this. We've briefly just brought up, you know, the big ones, the Terminator, Aliens, The Abyss, Terminator 2, Titanic, Avatar. It behooves me to ask you, because this is important for the discussion we're about to have you ever seen Piranha 2, The Spawning, what is dubbed or what is credited as Cameron's first feature film?
I saw it many, many moons ago. I don't remember a ton about it other than when I saw it, I was not very impressed by it. I did think it was quite a step down from the original Piranha, which, if I'm not mistaken, was directed by Joe Dante.
Yes, absolutely. Well, for the purpose of me bringing this up, by the way, I've seen it one time and it's it's not really a Cameron film. And I would invite listeners to check out the episode I did on sort of the history of the Terminator. The reason I bring it up is because if Cameron hadn't done work on Piranha 2, The Spawning, we would have never got the Terminator. Because Piranha 2, The Spawning was done by an Italian producer who produced many, many cheap horror movies, hired Cameron really just to really basically used Cameron. You know, Cameron shot for like 4 or 5 days. He ended up in Italy to see a rough cut of the film. He quickly realized that most of what he had filmed wasn't used, that they had inserted a bunch of B-movie horror tropes with centerfolds, and it just, he was utterly dismayed by what he saw. And he was in Rome. He's broke. He has no money. He's in a hotel room. He's literally eating food off of the leftover room service carts that he finds on the hall in the hallway because he has no money. He ends up getting food poisoning. He falls asleep. He has a terrible, terrible fever from the food poisoning. And he has a dream. He has a vision about a metal robot that, you know, metal skeleton sort of coming after him and chasing him. And that was sort of the inspiration for the Terminator. That's where he got the idea. But none of that would have happened if he hadn't been involved in the production of Piranha 2. Now, were you aware of that story?
I wasn't aware of the food poisoning in the hotel room. I was aware that he was so upset with Piranha 2 that that kind of inspired him to write the movie. But no, that's a fascinating anecdote. I was not aware of that.
Yeah, so that basically he found his way back to America. He wrote the script, and that's sort of how we got the ball rolling on the Terminator. And again, I invite listeners to listen to the History Of episode that I did, which I think currently is on the Patreon, but I will release it on the main feed by the time this episode comes out. So let's get into it. Mike, I'm going to ask you a question. When did you first see the Terminator? And the follow-up question to that is, what does this film mean to you?
So I actually, believe it or not, saw The Terminator opening weekend. I think I saw it probably that Friday. I would have been 8. And for those that have listened to the 20th Century Movie Club, you know that my parents had, shall we say, very flexible standards about what movies I could and couldn't see. So my old man and I went and saw this because I was already a big Schwarzenegger fan because I loved Conan. So I had wanted to see this one because I had seen the posters and stuff. My family used to go to movies every week. And when the reviews hit that Friday in our local paper, and it got, you know, 3.5 or 4 stars from the local reviewer, all of a sudden it wasn't me twisting my dad's arm to go see it. So he and I went on a Friday afternoon. I must have been out of school or something. And we were both just blown away. I mean, just absolutely blown away. It's a memory. My dad and I still actually talk about it anytime the Terminator comes up. It is a memory that I will always cherish. So this movie actually means a ton to me. But yeah, we were just taken. I was kind of expecting, you know, sort of Conan, but in the future. And what we got was something just completely different and something on a level that we were not expecting. And so, you know, this has been a movie that's been in my DNA for decades. And every time I watch it, you know, I just rewatched it for this podcast. Every time I watch it, I think I love it a little bit more because I just find more to love about it. How about you, Dana? What's your experience with the movie?
You know, it's interesting because I am a couple years younger than you. So this was not a film that I saw in the theater. I would have been 6 years old when the film came out. My first experience seeing this was in 1989 on television, which would have been a heavily edited version of the film. And to be honest with you, I don't think the real impact of this film hit me until after I saw Terminator 2 Judgment Day. I was just a little bit too young to understand themes that Cameron was exploring in this first Terminator film. But, you know, obviously, history has shown with me that I think it's just an incredible film. It's on a completely different level. It's so fucking intelligent. I mean, this is 1984. We're getting so much schlocky action films. And I almost wonder, there's a question I will pose to you right now. I almost wonder if the name of the film might have hurt its, you know, it's the perception of the film before people saw it in 1984. What do you think?
I mean, I think that coupled with the fact that it starred Schwarzenegger, who at that point literally was, you know, really just known for Conan, which I love, but which is a brilliantly schlocky, you know, fantasy action movie. But yeah, I do think it probably hurt it, although it's hard to say when you look at the box office that the movie actually pulled in relation to its budget. It's hard to say that it hurt it. And, you know, the thing to remember, in 1984, we didn't live in a world where pre-buzz made or broke a movie. You know, a movie like this could actually take its time to find an audience. And I certainly think that it had to take its time to find an audience. But clearly, you know, clearly it did. It is interesting, though, because when you hear The Terminator, it sure does seem like, you know, we were getting a bunch of Death Wish knockoffs at the same time, like The Exterminator and The Executioners and stuff like that all around the same time. And they were all these sort of schlocky, you know, they would be direct to VOD now if they existed, kind of 42nd Street movies. And so it's certainly, when you first hear it, you think it fits within that category of movies. But clearly, well, as soon as, like, from the opening scene, you know it doesn't. You know you're watching something that's on a completely different level.
What are your thoughts on just the time travel aspects of the film? Because I don't want to get into the whole, is it realistic? But And we'll get into it, I think, later on in subsequent episodes. But just the time travel elements alone. I mean, let's just talk about the plot of the film. For anyone that hasn't seen The Terminator, the basic plot of the film is machine is sent back from the future to 1984 to kill the mother of the unborn leader of the human resistance that will eventually topple the machines that have taken over the world. I mean, that's at its most basic plot here. I mean, this is kind of heavy stuff for 84. What do you think?
Yeah, it is. It's hard sci-fi. And it's also, you know, as I'm sure most people listening know, you know, Cameron initially envisioned this as a horror movie. When Schwarzenegger signed on, it became more of an action movie. But I one of the things I love about it is those horror movie roots are still in this movie. It is a very horrifying and horrific movie. And that is a very, very intense setup. You know, and you don't get a lot of buildup to it. Cameron puts just enough of the world of the future in this movie that, like you mentioned earlier, Dana, you feel it. It feels lived in. But he doesn't spend a lot of time telling us how this world works. It's kind of like one of the things I love about The Road Warrior, too. You know, George Miller just throws us in. Some kind of apocalypse has happened. The world is a desolate wasteland and people are fighting over gas. And that's all you need to know. Fuck off and enjoy the movie.
Yeah.
You know, and that's basically exactly how Terminator works. We get that brilliant opening scene of the machines, and I don't want to get all off track with it here, but man, the special effects in that opening scene are unbelievable, even by today's standards. And that just immediately paints the picture, and then boom, we're in 1984, and the Terminator is coming back, and we're off to the races. I mean, the efficiency of this movie is just, as you know, Dana, I'm very big on efficient. I don't care if a movie's 3 hours long or 75 minutes long. What I care about is their flab. And there is no flab on this movie. This thing just moves from the opening second all the way to the credits.
So I want to ask you a question, because this is the one I've always got sort of posited. This is the one I always want to sort of posit to people upon first-time viewers. Were we supposed to know that Arnold was sort of this machine, or is it the big reveal happened at the Tech Noir nightclub when Kyle Reese just unloads with him on the shotgun and he gets up?
I think we're not. I think we're supposed to know that something's up, because he gets stabbed by Brian Thompson, doesn't he?
Yeah.
At the start. Yeah. So we know that something's up with him. I don't know that we know necessarily he's a machine, but we certainly know that there's something unusual about him. But, you know, that also, what's great about that is, again, Conan being a huge success at the time, that also just sort of plays into that, right? We already conceptualized Schwarzenegger as this mightier than sort of normal human person. As far as a true machine goes, I'm not sure that we were supposed to know. I certainly know that when I saw it in 1984, I wasn't expecting to see some of the things that we saw down the road as far as actually seeing the internal components of him. I never expected that or saw that coming.
So let's just talk a little bit about the film itself. So like you said, it opens up this brilliant special effects extravaganza in the future. Minimal exposition as far as what's going on. It just says basically the machines have rose from the ashes of a nuclear fire. You know, they say the war will happen in our time, at our present here. And you said you get the reveal of the Terminator. And great scene when he walks up and, you know, has the three punks. You mentioned Bill Paxton and the other guys. And that's just a terrific scene. What do you think about that one?
I love that scene. I had totally forgotten that Bill Paxton and Brian Thompson were two of the guys. I think it's a great scene. It's amusing because, for those who don't know, Brian Thompson is the guy with the very angular, pronounced jaw. He's played bad guys in several movies. He's in, you know, one of our 20th Century Movie Club favorites. He's in Miracle Mile. Then Bill Paxton's just always Bill Paxton. It actually got me thinking, because this was right around the time, not to go off on too much of a tangent, but this was right around the time Bill Paxton was in Martini Ranch. Do you remember Martini Ranch at all, Dana?
That's like the kind of the new wave punk band, right?
Or, it's his new wave band that he's in. They have a song called Reach that the video is actually directed by James Cameron.
That's right, yeah.
And I love Reach. Reach is just one of my favorite songs of all time. So it just, that Bill Paxton that's in this is the same Bill Paxton that's in that band. And so it just, it amused me. But it also completely sets up the Terminator as a character perfectly, right? I need your clothes and your boots or whatever, you know, and nice night for a walk. And we get this sense that there is something off with him. And I remember reading in an interview, Cameron said that it was great because Schwarzenegger's accent almost worked in favor because he doesn't quite sound human already, right? Like there's something off. They hadn't quite gotten the voice. The machines hadn't quite gotten the voice down to sound like a human yet. And Schwarzenegger plays that perfectly. And we get that set up in this scene. We get how strong he is, how emotionless he is, and how sort of laser focused on whatever his mission is, all within just a couple of minutes while having a little bit of comic relief because who doesn't like watching goofy 80s punks get beaten up?
Yeah, well, doesn't he rips the guy's heart out.
Yeah,
that's just it's just great. Now, juxtapose that with the introduction of Michael Biehn's character, Kyle Reese. I mean, we've seen Arnold show up and he's flawless. There's nothing wrong with him. He's perfect. He's just, you know, and then Kyle Reese shows up and he just drops out. And it's a very sort of seedy part of like the downtown Los Angeles area. And he just, pardon my French, he just looks fucked up from the journey he's just had.
He's injured. He's wounded. He's what's so great about this. And I remember when I saw this in the theater, I don't even know that I'd seen a trailer, but I was most surprised that Schwarzenegger was the bad guy. Cause I think I had only seen the poster. I have vague recollections of being surprised that he was the bad guy. But what I love about this is how Cameron contrasts the utterly alien machine nature of the Terminator with the almost painfully human nature of Kyle Reese, right? I mean, he's in a seedy part of town. The trip back through time has very clearly taken its toll on him. He's shivering. He's naked. And as we go on, we also get one of the things I love that the way Cameron sort of portrays his very debilitating PTSD that he clearly has. You know, Reese is such an anomaly at this time for an action hero in a movie. He really is. We have much more human action heroes now, but this was the height of, you know, Rambo and Conan and Commando comes out the next year, you know, and Kyle Reese is such a human, vulnerable hero. I think Cameron was way ahead of the curve on creating a hero like Reese.
Yeah, no, I agree with you on that. What I like about this is we're only 10 minutes into the film, if that, and we really don't know who's who. And that's a good point you put about who's the good guy and who's the bad guy. Cameron doesn't hold our hand through this. He just basically says, all right, here's two guys. And, you know, they're both clearly on a mission. And we're just going to get kind of drips and drabs of what they're doing. And there's just, you know, the great scene of Arnold just grabbing a phone book, and he's just systematically looking for the name Sarah Connor, and there's three Sarah Connors on the list. And he's, you know, we still don't know what exactly he's there to do. I mean, it's just brilliant how he just sort of sets that up. So we get the introduction, we see the name Sarah Connor, then we get the introduction of Linda Hamilton, and she is just driving on a scooter, driving to her job as a waitress. I mean, basically, we're just effectively setting up. She's young. I think there's a reference to her being in college. And we just kind of get introduced to her, and she's just kind of, you know, living day to day. And I think there's an interesting scene when she is at the restaurant and she is trying to figure out who's ordered what, and the customers are giving her kind of a hard time, and she's not really standing up for herself. She's just kind of like, ugh. You just see that she struggles with kind of just the day to day of this job that she has.
It's a great setup. It is one thing I chuckled this time because I eat out a lot, and I gotta tell you, I see this all the time in movies. I'm not sure I've ever seen a restaurant that monumentally rude to a single lake, but it's good shorthand. You know, they use it in movies all the time, right? And it is still, it's a great scene. It's a great setup to make us immediately sympathetic to Sarah. You know, you get that little brat that puts the ice cream in her apron, and the guy's like, oh, I should give you the tip, kid. And it's like, you already, what's so important about this setup is we need to do a couple of things in very short order in this movie. We need to fall in love with Sarah Connor. And, you know, that's easy enough to do because Linda Hamilton's great. But we also need, as the audience, to want to protect her so that we can empathize with Reese and fear the Terminator the way we're supposed to. And that scene, coupled with the you know, not to jump ahead, but the scene where the guy, her date, cancels on her really gives us quite a bit of sympathy for her and makes us want to kind of spend time with her. It's a great setup that Cameron really does here. I think, again, the efficiency, the way he's doing this in just one or two scenes is so impressive.
And again, not to backtrack there, but when Kyle is being chased by the police, like the police have just seen him in the alleyway putting on a pair of pants, they chase him through the department store. He manages to escape and he gets a shotgun. So he's now armed. He's got a shotgun. He saws the butt off of it and he's got a trench coat and he's now on his mission. We then get a scene, just a great scene of the Terminator inside a guns and ammo store, basically. And he's just going through a systematic checklist of every gun that he sees. It's like the Uzi 9mm, you know, the 12-gauge autoloader. And, you know, he's got, and the gun salesman, he's very enthusiastic. He's like, oh, you really know your guns, buddy. And he goes through every gun that's on there, that's up there on the rack. And he goes, what else for you? And he asks for the phase plasma rifle and the 40-watt range. And the gun owner's like, hey, buddy, just what you see. Like, it's just, it's awesome. I love that scene.
Yeah, no, it's great. And I do want to shout out that the pawn shop owner is the glorious, almighty Dick Miller, yeah. Who was a good friend of Joe Dante's, showed up in all of Joe Dante's movies. Great sort of B movie horror movie actor, and he's great in this. I love him in this. He's just he's so Dick Miller in this. It's awesome.
Yeah,
yeah, it's great.
He goes, hey pal, just what you see. Then Dick Miller says, what, you know, all of these are great for, you know, home self-defense, which one's it going to be? And he's like, all of them. He's like, I'm going to close early today. And so, but ultimately there's not a sale that goes through. But my question is, the Terminator, for being so systematic, you wonder why he would just go through the trouble of, you know, going to the gun store. Why didn't he just walk in there and just take whatever he wants? I mean, do you think he's been programmed to try to blend in a little bit?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's, you know, they mention, Reese mentions that the whole point of the Terminators, the new model is designed for infiltration, right? They look like humans. They're designed to infiltrate and go in. So it's not in his nature. It's not his mission to create a big scene. Now, ultimately, as we see later on in the movie, he will, if he needs to accomplish his task. But, and I keep referring to him as he, it's a machine, it's an it, but it's Arnold Schwarzenegger. So I'm just going to say he, you know, but he's supposed to be an infiltrator. And so to walk in and do it, I mean, yeah, he still kills the guy, but he's doing it on the down low this way, I think, because that's a much more stealthy way of accomplishing his goal.
Absolutely. And then we get the scene of the Terminator showing up at a house, knocks on the door. He doesn't know. Let's just be clear. Like, he doesn't know what Sarah Connor looks like. He only has a name.
Yeah, absolutely. That's why he's going. That's why we get him going through the phone book. And we actually get a scene of Reese going through the phone book as well. Although we will find out that there is a difference because Reese actually does know what Sarah Connor looks like.
Absolutely.
So he only has to try and track down the right Sarah Connor.
And there's three in the phone book. We see an on-screen death where he does take out the first Sarah Connor. Flashback to Sarah's at work, and one of her coworkers is like freaking out, saying, oh my God, you got to watch the TV, you got to watch the TV. And it's a news report where she watches the reporter say that, you know, a lady by the name of Sarah Connor is dead. And that right there in the beginning is just looking like a coincidence. So we get Sarah back at her apartment. We meet her roommate, Ginger. This is, like you mentioned, Sarah finds out that she, you know, her date is canceled on her. She's going to go out. And again, we're just establishing that, you know, we, like you said, we feel for her. You know, we sympathize with her. She's a very likable person. She's kind of getting screwed over a little bit in life, it seems like. But nothing is really like giving us the idea that she's going to be this, you know, tough, fearless future, you know, mother of the resistance. And she decides to go out to a movie. We get a flash. We get Kyle back in a car. He has a flashback. This is the first time we sort of see him fighting in the future, which again, I'll turn it over to you. Incredible effects the way they did this. The movie did not have a big budget. It was a $6 million film, which was good for 1984, but it doesn't look like a $6 million film.
No, it doesn't. The things that Cameron's able to accomplish on this budget in these future scenes is still just jaw-dropping. And in a lot of ways, I actually think it's I'm almost sad that Cameron fell in love with CGI the way he did, because the model work in this and the model work and puppetry work in Aliens are still so amazing to me. And you compare that to, as beautiful as Avatar looks, the sort of squishy way all of the CGI in that movie feels, it just, I miss this, because I hadn't probably watched this movie in maybe, I don't know, 10 years before I rewatched it for this podcast. And I just still, we hit those future scenes and I'm there, man. I am in that scene. I'm in that car with Reese as he's, you know, as they're trying to get away. And it is so, I'm kind of stumbling over my words here, but it just paints such a picture of what this godforsaken hell world that Reese comes from looks like, that I just don't know that you could replicate that with CGI in a way that would have the same tact. And I'm not one of the CGI haters, but I just think the tactile feel for this world is so impressive.
That first vision we get of Kyle in the future, like, you see how methodical the machines are. Like, you see the soldier that's fighting with Kyle just get blown apart by this machine. Like, it's just so matter of fact, and it's just brutal. And again, want to spend some time in this world as far as exploring a little bit more. And he just gives us drips and drabs. He just gives us enough to want more. It's incredible.
Well, and I'm going to put a pin in this, because that is something that I think we will come back to as this series goes on, of a significant problem with a lot of the sequels, is that they want to give us more of the things that Cameron just gives us drips of. And frankly, this movie is a perfect example of sometimes less is more. The less we know about the future, I think the more effective the future is. And this movie is perfect for that.
We're going to be introduced to the two police officers here. It's going to be Paul Winfield and Lance Hendrickson. And Lance Hendrickson would go on to be in Aliens and have a fantastic role. He's been a friend of Cameron for quite some time. They're starting to put it together that there's been a second homicide, and they're comparing the names, and they're realizing that there's the two women are both named Sarah Connor, and they, you know, they realize that there's a third Sarah Connor. So now the police are now looking for Sarah Connor. So now you've got three people looking for her. You've got the Terminator, you've got Kyle, and now the police are trying to track her down because they're calling this, you know, the phone book killer. Again, no one is saying, how could this be happening? No one is saying, you know, like, I love that this is so, this film that is so, like, futuristic in some parts is so grounded in reality.
Yeah, absolutely. It's just, it's gritty and it's grimy. And you really get a sense here of this is a lived-in sort of world where the underbelly of this world is pretty unpleasant, shall we say. You know, it's certainly not the bright, sunshiny LA that we see in a lot of other LA-based 80s movies. It's definitely kind of a seedier version. I mean, even the club, which we're, you know, we'll talk about in just a sec, even that is, it's not like a necessarily like a sexy, glamorous club. It's kind of a little bit of a seedy club itself. But yeah, the cops are thoroughly unimpressed by the fact that they might have a serial killer here. Like, it's just matter of fact for them.
Yeah, no, Winfield even goes, oh, here's what we call a goddamn phone book killer. Like, they're just like, oh, they're already thinking how the media is going to spin this. And so all of this is basically, so we've established now that Sarah's date has canceled on her. She's going to go out. We've met the roommate. The roommate's boyfriend is getting ready to come over, and that's going to be important here because, again, the Terminator has gone through two names on the list, and he is now going for the third one. And this, again, goes back to something you said, because when I watched this last week, this whole scene where the Terminator breaks into Sarah's apartment and takes out the boyfriend, which, by the way, he valiantly tries to, you know, he gives it an effort to fight back, you know, hits him with the lamp and everything. This
shout out to Rick Rossovich, aka Slider from Top Gun.
Absolutely, absolutely. And he you know, I give him credit. He at least tries to defend himself and Ginger. But something you said about sort of the horror movie elements of this felt very sort of Friday the 13th-ish, very Halloween-ish, this scene where Ginger and him are taken out.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is one of those, you know, and the Terminator really is kind of a slasher in this. He's an unstoppable monster. And this is a perfect, you could absolutely see, you know, you replace the Terminator with Jason and you replace Ginger and her boyfriend with some dumb college kids in a camp, and you could have this exact same scene. And the other thing it does really well is, you know, Rick Rossovich isn't a small dude. I mean, he's not 5'6". He's a pretty big, fit guy. And so he gives it his all, but the Terminator just, you know, pounds him into hamburger with little or no effort, which again very efficiently establishes just how unstoppable this machine is. You know, we're really starting to get a sense of this isn't a normal person or a, you know, this is something else. And so I think, again, it's a great way that Cameron gives us that information visually that we need to know. Because you mentioned very little exposition in this entire movie, very little exposition. It's all communicated visually, and he's so good at that, particularly in this movie.
And when Sarah makes the decision that she's just going to go out by herself, she tells Ginger she's going to go see a movie. She goes to the parking lot, and we see that Kyle has found where she lives. Like, Kyle is now following her, but he doesn't seem to be trying to make contact with her. He's just following her. But you, as the audience, as a first-time viewer, you're not 100% sure what his motives are. Just at this point, we now establish that he's just keeping an eye on her. She gets to a pizzeria or a bar. She's watching the news, and she hears that, you know, another Sarah Connor has been killed. Now she's starting to put the pieces together. And there's an interesting scene where she calls 911 on the payphone, and they just put her on hold. And I'm just thinking, that just doesn't work like that anymore. That was probably still a rudimentary system back then. She leaves the pizzeria. She's walking down the hall, walking down the sidewalk. She sees that Kyle's following her. This is where she jumps into the Tech Noir bar, which, by the way, had a $4.50 cover charge. And that was a lot for 1984. Can I just put it out as somebody who used to DJ a lot at nightclubs? That was a hell of a cover charge. Just random thought.
Yeah, there better be a good DJ there. Yeah. And just as a side note, there is an EDM band called Gunship that has a great song called Tech Noir. So everybody should check that out and listen to it, because it's very, if you like sort of that 80s synthwave sound, you'll appreciate that song.
Oh, and I just want to say, great. The two songs that play in the Tech Noir bar, the two scenes where the two different songs, fantastic. Listen to them all the time. Absolutely fantastic. It's well at the Tech Noir bar that Sarah's able to get a hold of the police, and they tell her, look, just stay in public. Don't go outside. Don't go to the restroom. You're in a safe spot. This is where the movie has spent, you know, 20 minutes, and it just all comes together for the first real action set piece. And I have to tell you, watching this movie again, there's a scene where she's sitting at a table. The Terminator is about to find her, and she knocks over a bottle, and she just reaches down to pick it up, and he just barely misses her. And like, that scene, I've seen this movie 100 times, is still so fucking tense.
Absolutely. And you get, what's great about it is the way Cameron is able to juggle all the moving parts. You've got the ambient background movement of this being a club. So you've just got a bunch of people. You've got Sarah at the table. You've got the Terminator. And then we've got Reese off to the side. And all these parts are moving. And we know they're going to eventually converge, but we don't know where or how. And he keeps juggling all these different parts throughout this scene until, you know, they all sort of coalesce together.
And the Terminator finally finds Sarah Connor. Another fantastic scene. He pulls up the handgun with the laser sight. You see it reflecting off her forehead. And he's about to shoot. And this is when Kyle jumps in with the shotgun. And like I said, we get this first great action set piece. He pumps 4 or 5 shots into the Terminator. The Terminator goes down. You see his hand slightly move, and then he gets back up. And this is the first part you realize that he is not human. Kyle and Sarah, they escape out of the club. The Terminator comes after them. Great scene where he jumps on the hood of the car and just puts his hand through the windshield. Just incredible. There's a great car chase. Now, this is where, this is important, this whole car chase scene, they dip into a underground parking garage. And this is where we get the full-on exposition. This is where we... The entire plot of the film is essentially laid out by Kyle. And it's a mesmerizing story that he tells. And she's, by the way, she's not having any of it in the beginning.
Yeah, no, absolutely not. And the way he tells it, you know, it. One thing I wanted to say is this is where it's great how Cameron slowly built up that the Terminator is not human. Because that way, when Kyle tells Sarah what the Terminator is, we as the audience have already been mentally prepared for that explanation. If that explanation just came in the first like 5 minutes of the movie, it would just seem silly, right? But Cameron's done such a great job of laying the groundwork and preparing us for that with both the flashbacks to the future, as well as the way we're seeing Schwarzenegger interact and get hurt and get back up, that when Kyle's like, oh, it's a cyborg, it's a machine with skin on the top, we're like, Oh, well, okay. Get it. It all makes sense now. Perfect. You know, but you're right. Sarah's not having any of it. And in fact, she reacts, I think, the way a lot of us probably would, especially because, and I'll give a hat tip to Michael Biehn here. You know, he's not exactly coming across as stable while he's trying to explain all these things to her. He is not coming across as calm and collected and rational. We did also skip over the fact that in the club, we get one of the key catchphrases of the entire Terminator series, which is when Kyle rescues her, he says, come with me if you want to live. And that will come back in, I think, pretty much every single movie. But yeah, she's not having any of it. But she's doing a great job of, I think, Hamilton's doing a great job of, I think, realistically being upset by all of this. You can also almost see that she's also looking for like a way out here. She's sort of trying to figure out, okay, I am in a pretty fucked up situation here. What do I do to get out of this? It's a great, very well acted scene.
And it's almost like when I was watching that scene, because she goes, look, I'm not stupid. They can't make things like that yet. So even though this is 1984, so even in 1984, we're inundated with enough rudimentary technology that nothing seems unbelievable. But she says, look, I'm not stupid. They can't make that yet. So I think it's great. That's sort of an understanding that we're starting to get the little drip of technology by 1984. So I thought that was just a kind of clever line that she said there. But I'll also agree with you that she is, I think, towards the end of his sort of, I'll use the term, exposition dump of all of what's going on and you know, who the Terminator is. I think she's starting to just say, sure, buddy, whatever you say. Because, like, I agree with you. She wants to get out of the situation. So she's just going to kind of calm him down, be like, okay, I believe you. And they escape into another car. He spends a little bit more time explaining a little bit more about who she is. The Terminator finds them again, and the police find them, and Kyle is arrested, and then we end up in the police station. And by the way, can I just say, love the banter back and forth between the two detectives.
Absolutely. They're great. I did also, I love that she, when she's in the car, you know, she actually waits for a moment and then she bites him hard. And I do love that we get, again, it's a nice little character piece with Reese, because he shows no emotion whatsoever, but then basically says, a Terminator can't be hurt. I can. Don't do that again. Yeah. You know, so it's like, but he doesn't, but we also really get the sense now that he is there to protect her, because he doesn't do anything to hurt her. He just is like, that actually really hurt. Please don't do that. Like, I would prefer it if you didn't try and bite my fingers off. It's just a nice little, again, character bit. And yeah, this is also when we find out that, you know, she is the mother of the leader of the resistance, which, that's pretty heavy, Dana. I've had some heavy conversations in my day, but nobody's ever told me I'm responsible for the future of mankind. Sarah, I like the way Hamilton plays it. She almost kind of, when she's in the police station, is almost in a little bit of shock, right? She's just sort of, what is happening here? But the scenes in the police station with the detectives are absolutely fantastic. I mean, Paul Winfield and Lance Henriksen are just, they're pros. They're pros in everything they've ever done.
Yeah. And just there's just couple little lines there, like one scene where he picks up the cup of coffee and it's like, that coffee is, you know, 3 hours old. I put a cigarette out and he still drinks it anyway. Like, they just have a lot of really fun back and forth banter. But what I really like about the police station scene, one, Sarah, for the first time, probably has that sense of I am safe now. Whoever that crazy guy was that tried to kill me in Tech Noir, he's not going to get me. Kyle is obviously under arrest, so this is the first time where she can sort of, like, and you said she's a bit in shock, and I think the weight of the entire experience she's just had, which would be fucking traumatizing to anyone, I think the weight of that is just finally hitting her. You know, she can see her, she's just mentally exhausted. And I love the scene where the police systematically explain to her point by point why Kyle is clearly just batshit crazy. He's making this up, and they have an excuse for everything that has happened. Why the Terminator punched his hand through the windshield, they say, well, he's probably on PCP. Why he got shot so many times, they bring out the big tactical bulletproof vest. Like, they have an explanation for everything, and I just think that's perfect, because, you know, we as the audience might be going, well, maybe Kyle's crazy. You know, like, I just love it. There's just little hints of that.
Well, and I love it too, because they're doing that and we're getting that, but then Cameron also is smart enough to know that we still need to like Kyle. And so shortly after that, we get it contrasted with the Terminator, you know, repairing himself exactly. in his hotel room and literally taking out an eye and stuff. And we're seeing now the Terminator vision with all the, you know, the computer monitors and all of that sort of stuff. And we get the famous look, it puts the sunglasses on. So again, we know that Kyle is actually the last sane man and everybody else is the one that is not and is just in denial about what's happening here. But they do such a good job of just even for a minute making us question that. And I think it's really well put together.
It's incredibly effective. So at this point, I've got to think because she starts watching a video where they've interviewed Kyle. They show Kyle the interview where they're questioning him. The police are questioning him. And he's got an answer for everything that they're asking him. I mean, he's very, you just know that he's, you know, by this point, you know he's telling the truth. Because we've already seen the scene where, like you said, where you see the Terminator repairing himself. And as the audience, you're starting to get a little frustrated, like, oh, this is not going to end well if Sarah doesn't get out of there, if Kyle doesn't get to Sarah. And then we get, you know, the Terminator walking into the police station. And we get, it's the first use of the most famous catchphrase that Arnold Schwarzenegger will ever have in almost every movie he ever does. It becomes a lampoon by I think, the late 90s. He just walks in. And again, like you said, infiltrator walks in, doesn't want to create a scene. He literally asks to speak to Sarah Connor. And the guy's like, yeah, can't see her. She's making a statement. You know, you have to come back later. You're welcome to wait, whatever. He looks around. And then what is the famous line that he says?
Oh, this is where we first get, I'll be back.
Exactly. And I love this because every time I watch this movie, I try to put myself in the mindset of what it would have been like to see this in the theater. I saw it when I was like a 10 or 11 years old. So the gravity of this film really was lost on me. But the scene when he says, I'll be back, and he leaves, and the guy at the front desk, he didn't give a shit. He's just back there doing paperwork. And the reaction when you see the car just come crashing into the police station, it just must have been mind-boggling to see that the first time.
It, as somebody who saw it in the theater, it was. And it was weird because I'll be back almost immediately became a kid. Like, it was one of those where it was like, you in that moment, in that scene, you were witnessing the birth of a catchphrase and the birth of a megastar. You know, Schwarzenegger had been building, but you are actually now witnessing the birth of a megastar. And I can't put my finger on why, but there was just something about it. I remember when I left the theater at 8 years old saying, I'll be back. Like, it just, the way it just hits. And then, yeah, what follows, of course, is you get that the car, and you're not expecting the car to come through. Like, it is, I think that's what makes it, is the almost like the setup. I'll be back is almost like the setup. The car coming through is the punchline, but we can't really, you know, replicate driving cars through walls. So I'll be back becomes the catchphrase. One thing I wanted to backtrack on a little bit is in that video of Kyle talking, and we'll talk about time travel. I think it's more important to kind of talk about it in Terminator 2. But one of the things I love about this one is it's very clear that this was meant to be a self-contained movie, because Reese says we had won. The Terminator had already come through. Connor sent me through and then blew up the time displacement equipment. Nobody goes home. Nobody comes through. It's just him and me. And for somebody, as listeners will find out, for somebody who by and large gets really aggravated with time travel, I loved this because it just sort of hand waves it and says, this is it. This is now fixed. I can't go home. He can't go home. We are solitary warriors who are going to kill one another, and that will one way or another be the end of it. And I thought that was, as somebody who doesn't love time travel, I thought that was a really good way of sort of closing the loop on this movie, in a way that I think a lot of the other movies fail to do, which I'm sure I will spend many, many moons talking about as we go further on. The other thing that goes along with that is earlier in the movie, Reese basically hand waves it because Sarah's asking him a little bit about the time travel, and he basically just says, I don't know, it's one possible future, but I don't know the tech stuff, which again just sort of hand waves all of it, which I think is the smartest decision this movie makes. Don't get bogged down in the time travel, just enjoy the ride.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And one more thing about that thing where he says, you know, I can't go back, you know, once it's done, it's done. That just kind of reaffirms to the police that, yep, you see, You know, you're, and there's another line, there's another great line in that one where they say, you know, why didn't you bring any weapons back from the future, like a ray gun or something like that? And smartly mentions that only living tissue can go through that displacement equipment.
And they, and I love it because the doctor even says, well, but you said the Terminator is a machine. And Reese says, yes, but surrounded by living tissue. But it's a perfectly reasonable question, right? You're telling me there's this killer robot, but only living things can go through. And then when Reese says, yeah, but surrounded by living tissue, well, that's mighty convenient. Mm. That's a very, you know, even though we know Reese is telling the truth, it's easy to see why everybody else would think he's suffering from some pretty serious mental illness.
And Earl Bowen plays the doctor, Dr. Silverman, and he's great. He's fantastic in this, and he's good in the second one, and he does have a cameo in the third one. But he is loving this guy. He's just like, I could make a career out of studying this guy. Like, he doesn't believe anything he's saying. He just thinks this is like the end all be all of somebody who's completely lost their mind mentally.
Yeah, this is the case study that is going to make his career, right? He's going to be on Oprah, and he's got book deals already. You can already see the wheels turning. He's got book deals and everything going on.
Now it's perfect. Perfect. So back to Arnold, just comes in, you know, he just crashes the car in there. And this is, again, this is one of the legendary scenes of the whole Terminator franchise, where Arnold just goes through calmly, methodically, and he's up against 30 cops. You know, they're all heavily armed, and they can't stop him at all. And it's just a massacre.
Yeah. And this is, again, this is that where the horror movie roots of this movie really shine through, right? I mean, this is a massacre scene. This isn't an action scene. This is a massacre. And it's very much, you can see Jason or Michael Myers doing the exact same thing here in this movie. This is pure horror. This scene is pure horror, and it's shot as such. I mean, Cameron shoots it. It's dark. He uses deep, dark shadows. Everything is kind of shot from a low angle to make Schwarzenegger look even bigger and taller than he already is. Just to kind of emphasize how trivial all these cops are to him. And you know, and we get Sarah basically realizing slow or very quickly that she's in a lot of trouble here. If this scene doesn't like viscerally get to you, I kind of feel like maybe you're just watching the movie the wrong way. You know, I mean, this scene is so intense. It's by far, in my opinion, the most intense scene in the entire movie.
Absolutely. Kyle manages to escape from the room he's locked in. He finds Sarah, you know, RIP to both Lance Henderson and, you know, Paul Winfield. They don't make it. There was one little clever scene that we forgot to mention there, and that is when Arnold is first entering the police station, the doctor is leaving, and his beeper goes off just at the moment where he would have made eye contact with this guy. And he looks down at his beeper and he goes out the door. So he survives. And so they have managed to escape, but everyone else in the police department is just slaughtered. They get out, they steal a car, runs out of gas. They're hiding basically under an underpass. And this is now the time when Sarah completely believes Kyle, and she wants to know more about the future. And this is where there's kind of a complete shift and turn in the way she feels about Kyle and everything that he said.
She's on board now, you know, and it's a shift. I mean, basically, we're sort of shifting essentially into the third act of the movie now. And she's on board from now until the rest of the movie. And we start to see the transformation into the Sarah Connor that we're going to see, not just through this movie, but through the rest of the series when she appears, because, you know, we start to see that there is this strength in Sarah that maybe wasn't quite as visible at the start of the movie. It's a really nice scene. And it also, the character work that Cameron does between Sarah and Kyle is really nice. They play off each other. Bean and Hamilton play off each other so well. They have such good on-screen chemistry. This is where we start to get a sense of she's going to protect him just as much as he's going to protect her. I think it's a really nice scene. We also sort of start to get the hints of why Reese is the one who actually came back in time.
She wants to know more about the future, and we get the final sort of, I keep saying flashback, but I guess flash forward to the future, and you see how everybody is just living, and it's just horrid conditions where they're basically chasing rats for food. You know, there's a scene where, you know, everyone that comes into the fortified bunker has to pet a dog because it gets established that Terminators can be spotted by dogs. You know, we see Kyle returning back to this, and it's just, again, a miserable, miserable existence and a miserable, just the whole thing. Just it's, you really feel for the situation that all of these people are living in, and a Terminator infiltrates and just starts wiping everybody out. Kyle has a picture of Sarah, and it's established that that's how he now knows what Sarah looks like, because he has a photograph of Sarah, but it's a Sarah that we haven't seen yet. It's a Sarah with wearing a headband, and it just doesn't look anything like the Sarah that we've seen so far.
She looks not older, but different. It's definitely good foreshadowing. Let's just put it that way.
After she wakes up, you know, she says, "I dreamed about dogs barking," and he just says, "Well, that's how we spot Terminators." We cut back to a scene of the Terminator inside, again, this really seedy, you know, looks like an hourly motel type of situation. And there's a janitor on the other side, and he says, "Hey, buddy, what, do you got a dead cat in there?" And it really wasn't like the last time I watched this movie that I realized that because his flesh is deteriorating on his face, that the smell that must be causing, because there's a scene where you see flies on his face. And I never really had put that together.
Yeah, it's a nice subtle touch. It also leads to one of my favorite, just absolute favorite scenes in the movie, where you get the Terminator scrolling response thing, and then you got, "Fuck you, asshole." You know, like, and that's what's nice about this, is there's not a lot of humor in this movie, right? This movie is, as a movie that was envisioned as a horror movie, there's not a lot of humor, but there is just enough to break some tension when you need it, to kind of give the audience a chance to breathe a little bit, because that's especially important in a movie that moves as quickly as this one does. If you don't want your audience to get overwhelmed and essentially just shut off, you need to have some little scenes like this where everybody can breathe and get a little chuckle at "fuck you, asshole," you know, and go about their, you know, and then they're back into the movie. It's a nice little touch here.
During that scene, he has taken Sarah's address book from her apartment, and he is just going through it page by page, and he finds that the mom, Sarah's mom, lives at a particular cabin, and he just decides to go up there. She makes the mistake, because by this point, Kyle and Sarah have checked into a little motel. He's gone out to buy supplies because he knows that this thing isn't over. Like, this Terminator's going to keep coming. And so he's got to figure out a way to try to stop it. We see a scene where the Terminator's in the cabin. There's a hole through the door, so you know that the mom has died, and he is imitating the mom's voice, and she gives up where they're at, gives up their location. So what we've established now is the clicking clock, which adds another layer of tension, because we know that the Terminator knows where they're at, and it's kind of like, okay, you guys need to get out of here.
But unfortunately, they don't. They don't know that, I should say. So it's a weird bit of tension. You know, you mentioned Reese is getting supplies. He's, you know, as we find out, he's basically trying to build pipe bombs, essentially, is all the supplies that he's getting. So we know, as the audience, coupled with the fact that the Terminator knows they're coming, coupled with the fact that Reese is building pipe bombs, we know that we're, without even, if you hadn't even looked at your watch, you could still tell, all right, we are heading into the final confrontation now. That's how well structured this movie is. It just, it flows in such a way that you're like, okay, everything's coming to a head right now. And I don't know, I'm kind of rambling on that. I love the pacing and the structure of this movie so much. It's some high-tech critique that I've given there, but I love it so much, Dana.
Yeah, and the film clocks in, I think, about an hour 47 minutes, which is a pretty decent-sized film, but you don't ever feel that running time everything just moves along at such a clip. And one of the things that, I say this also about RoboCop, if you were to ask me how long the original RoboCop is, I would tell you that movie's more than 2 hours long. Because I remember every scene so vividly that it just seems like a longer movie. I was shocked to see that it was only an hour and 40 minutes long. Yep. And I think this is the same thing applies to this film here. If you were to ask me how long this movie is, I'd say, well, that's clearly a 2 hour and 10 minute long film. But you remember all the scenes so vividly.
And every scene counts.
Yes.
No scene is wasted. Every scene conveys valuable information and moves the plot forward. That's one of the things that happens a lot when we feel like movies are long is because there's scenes in them that might be nice, but they're not conveying any valuable information or moving the plot forward in any way. There is not an ounce of fat on this movie.
And that speaks to what you said about Cameron's technical prowess as a filmmaker. Like he identifies that, and that is typically up until Avatar, I would say that would be the case with mostly every one of his films. Would you agree?
Yeah, I think True Lies is pretty flabby. True Lies is, you know, but for me, True Lies is actually my least favorite Cameron movie, because I think that one's pretty flabby in the middle of the movie. But for the most part, I would agree with you. I think even Titanic, as long as it is a movie that every scene is conveying valuable information, either about the plot or the characters or something. And certainly, you know, I think Aliens is just a masterclass in visual storytelling. So I would agree with you for the most part.
By this point, Sarah and Kyle, there's obviously some real chemistry between the two of them. Sarah sees it. Kyle sees. Well, Kyle knows. Does Kyle know? That's the question I've always wondered. Was Kyle sent back knowing that he was going to be John Connor's father? No, he couldn't have known that, right? That would have been too much information to give him.
Yeah, I don't think so, because then you'd run the risk of him doing things that would alter the timeline. So I don't think, obviously John knows, which is why John picks him to go back, but I don't think he knows. And I don't get the sense that he knows, because he's trying to avoid, you know, as he's telling Sarah why he's the one that came back, he's trying to avoid telling her this. He doesn't want this to happen. And so, which I get, that would be weird. Hey, best friend, I banged your mom. So I don't think he knows. I don't think there's anything that conveys to us that he does know how important he actually is to this whole, you know, future.
Yeah. And I agree with you. There can't be another explanation for that. Like he couldn't have known that, because you're right. Because that would have been, I think this would have been too much pressure on you as far as, you know, don't screw anything up. So they end up, for lack of a better term, they end up getting romantically involved in the hotel. And there's a love scene, which again, love scenes incredibly rare in Cameron films.
The thing that I love about this scene is Cameron isn't, for me, normally a very romantic director. I mean, I know he's made one of the greatest romances of all time in Titanic, but I even still feel like that is kind of on Leo and Kate a little bit more than it's on the words that Cameron wrote for them. What he pulls off here is amazing, because Kyle and Sarah have to fall in love in a very short amount of time. And in order for it to work as well as it does, you know, people fall in love in short times in movies all the time, right? I mean, that's just, but most of the time that doesn't work. We just kind of roll our eyes at it. This one I buy wholeheartedly. I think that the chemistry between Linda Hamilton and Michael Biehn, the way the characters interact, I fell in love with both of them, and I completely buy that they fell in love with each other. And I think it's important to note that Cameron really does do a nice job of shooting this sex scene. It's not shot in an exploitative way. It's shot with kind of soft lighting and really is a culmination of where the characters are. I think it's a very important scene in the movie, you know, that I think you'd lose something if you were to cut it out. I don't know that he's ever accomplished that with any other love scene that he's shot in any of his movies. Titanic may come close, but I think this one, he accomplishes something that he typically doesn't accomplish.
I agree 100% with what you said there. So from this point on, we're into the final chase scene, this just turns into a straight up, you know, Mad Max chase scene for the next 25 minutes. They're leaving the hotel. They hear the dogs barking. The Terminator's there. They're in a truck. He's on a motorcycle. I mean, it's great. Let's just say what it is. This is a fantastic chase scene. They're throwing the pipe bombs. He's shooting the machine guns. It's awesome.
Yeah, it is. We get one thing I do want to point out. We get a really, again, kind of the last nice character bit right before the chase starts is when Kyle and Sarah wake up the next morning. She jokingly goes to throw the bag of pipe bombs at him. You know, she's like, think fast. And he actually smiles. And it's the only time in the entire movie that Kyle smiles. And so it's a really nice character bit that I think just sort of establishes, again, really sets their relationship as important as it is. But then, yeah, we immediately go into just, you know, Mad Max Fury Road here, pipe bombs and trucks and all sorts of stuff exploding. And again, what Cameron's able to accomplish on an incredibly limited budget is staggering, because these are all practical effects. We're seeing practical explosions and things like that that are just riveting to watch.
During the scene when Kyle is throwing the pipe bombs out, he is hit by the Terminator. He is wounded by the Terminator. And it becomes really, the responsibility falls on Sarah now to really escape from the Terminator, while also protecting Kyle. So we've sort of seen the shift in things here now, where she's kind of running the show as far as, you know, she's ramming the motorcycle, you know, into the guardrail. She's taking him out. Of course, that ends up causing the truck to flip over. He hijacks a gas truck. I mean, it's all happening rather quickly, but it's establishing that she has become, from where she was at the beginning of the film, we've seen a monumental shift in her.
Yeah, and we even get, when she's trying to get Reese up, you know, she finally starts calling him soldier and, you know, get up, soldier. And just the way her whole demeanor and her tone changes, you know, Linda Hamilton's really is really convincing us of how Sarah is changing, or even if not changing, maybe finding the strength and the leadership that was already there, and just life wasn't allowing it to come out. But yeah, she really does become sort of Reese's protector here, rather than the other way around.
And this movie has a very famous, what we call, you know, the fake out endings, where the Terminator is chasing them in the gasoline truck. Kyle musters up the strength. He's got one pipe bomb left. He manages to just throw it sort of into the back, like there's a pipe sort of below the tank of the tanker truck. You know, they dive into a dumpster. The thing goes off, massive explosion. And you think the movie's over, because the Terminator has obviously been destroyed. And then we just get the fucking most amazing scene where, you know, now it's just the exoskeleton of the Terminator rises up. And I believe that was all, was that Stan Winston effects, I think?
Stan Winston, yeah. Baby.
And
the,
I
mean, almighty.
Come on, like, you can, look, say what you want about CGI. You can't replicate that scene where that exoskeleton just rises up from the debris. It's unbelievable. Still gives me chills when I watch it.
Yeah, no, and the way it moves with a weight. And again, I hate to overuse the word tactile, but it feels tactile. It's one of the reasons that, you know, I, as you know, I love Godzilla movies. It's one of the reasons I like the guys in the rubber suits in Godzilla movies. There's just a feel there that, yeah, maybe, okay, the special effects we get in, you know, where we can create Thanos essentially out of nowhere is equally as impressive. But there is something about just seeing an actual robot move, you know, and knowing, if you know about the movies, knowing that there's guys that are basically moving it, you know, one micro step at a time and taking single pictures. It's the same way that, you know, the Willis O'Brien King Kong is still dazzling to me after 90 years. I will never not love practical effects like this.
Yeah. So they're now being chased by the skeleton, the exoskeleton. They get into a robotics factory. Kyle tells Sarah, you know, turn on all the machines. It will fuck with his tracking. And it's just, again, this goes back to more horror movie elements as far as the slasher coming out, like a slasher movie. This is how this final scene played out for me.
Yeah, absolutely. Because they're still not on equal terms, right? This is not a one-on-one, typically what you'd expect from an action movie last fight, right? Action movie last fights are the hero and the villain. They square off and they go toe-to-toe. And this is, they're still being chased by a monster and they are literally just trying to survive. This isn't about looking cool or doing awesome moves or anything like that. This is just, oh God, what can we do to survive here? And it does. It feels very much like a horror movie.
And Kyle valiantly tries, you know, tells Sarah to run. He's got the pipe and he is doing everything he can. He's bashing. It's great. He's just bashing the skeleton, the exoskeleton's head, the Terminator's head. And so you see the head just kind of flip to the side and then bounce back up. It's just so awesome. Like the way he just shoots all of this, like Cameron, like it's just incredible. Kyle dies. I mean, just let's just say where it is. Spoiler alert, by the way, if you've listened this far and you haven't seen The Terminator, shame on you. You should have stopped. It's it's very readily available. We'll go over that at the end of this episode. And then Sarah is, she's wounded. She's basically been reduced to just crawling and pulling herself. And she gets through this hydraulic press. The Terminator follows her through the press. She gets out. Great line. Pushes the button, says, "You're Terminator, fucker." Again, the transformation that we've seen Sarah make is just incredible. And this machine, this hydraulic press, just crushes the Terminator, and that's it. Or so we thought.
Yeah, I mean, it's incredible. It's such a cathartic sort of release when she says, "You're terminated, fucker." You know, there's a reason that, like, these 80s style last lines really took off, because they are a cathartic release, especially in a movie like this that is just so intense and so, you know, overwhelming. To have that just immediate release is just so nice when you get to the end of the movie.
Oh, it's like the end of Jaws when he says, "Smile, yeah, you son of a bitch." Like, there's just, yep, those great one lines that come out of these films.
Yeah, so absolutely. And it has the same impact as the one in Jaws. I love it.
Absolutely. So we get flash forward a few months. By this point, Sarah has now made it to Mexico. She's on a Jeep. She's clearly pregnant, so we know now that Kyle was obviously the father of John. She is taken to doing audio recordings to basically tell John everything he needs to know when he gets older. She stops at a gas station, gets gas, you know, little boy takes her picture, and we end up seeing that's the picture, that's a Polaroid, that's the picture that Kyle had in the future, and it sort of all just comes full circle. And then she just drives off, you know, into the distance, or a kind of bad map painting. But anyway, that's, you know, neither here nor there.
And we get, I think, two great lines here at the very end. One where she's recording the message to John, and she says, "God, a person could go crazy thinking about all this," because she's trying to decide to tell him about Kyle or not. And again, I sort of love the hand waving of the time travel and the weird time loop. Yeah. But then I think the ending line is just so perfect, when the little boy takes her picture and says something to her, and she looks at his father and says, "What did he say?" And he says, he says there's a storm coming, and she just kind of looks ahead and goes, "I know." And then that's when she drives. Like, it just is such a perfect way to end the movie, because we get the, like, yeah, she has now fully become Sarah Connor, the mother of, you know, the savior of mankind at that point. And I love that last line for the movie.
Unless we forget Brad Fidel, who did the music for this film and would subsequently go on to do the music for Terminator 2, did an amazing job. The score on this one is perfect.
I was going to make sure that we talked about it, because, yeah, the score on this, and I mean, that theme is instantly iconic, but actually the entire score is just really fantastic. He manages to do something in the main theme that is really hard to pull off, which is he makes it both intense and scary while also, like, uplifting, you know, because you've got the underlying, that metal clanging sound that is just so unnerving, but then you have the melody over it that is kind of this uplifting, and I don't know music, so I'm not going to use the right terms of keys and stuff like that, but it's just such a phenomenal theme, and he's able to split that and weave it out throughout the entire movie. It's a perfect score. And it's one of the all-time great scores.
And dare I say, and we'll get into this when we talk about Terminator 2, he perfects that score with Terminator 2, in my opinion.
Yes, I agree.
All right, well, Mike, I think you and I are just going to have to make the decision right now that we planned on talking about both the Terminator and Terminator 2 in this episode. That's not going to happen.
not unless we want people to listen to a four-hour podcast, which I don't think we do.
So I think what we're going to do is we'll just go ahead and wrap that discussion up now, and then next week we'll go ahead and jump into Terminator Part 2, or Terminator 2 Judgment Day. But before we go, you know, we've been talking so much about this film, I'd love to be able to tell listeners where they can find it. It's ready to stream right now, free with ads on the Roku app. It's available to stream on Showtime, Fubo, and Showtime with the Amazon subscription. And it's available for rental or purchase on all major platforms. So,
and it typically shows up. It's usually like $5 to buy it digitally. Yeah. You know, it fluctuates, but I think I bought my digital copy for like $4 during a sale at some point. So yeah. There's no reason not to see this movie.
So I guess the last question I'll have here is, and we're going to ask it about all of the Terminator films. Do you recommend The Terminator?
I do. I think this is an all-time great movie. I think this one's an all-timer. It is lay my cards on the table. It is actually the only one in the series that for me, I think is a true all-timer. But I think this movie is perfect. There is not a single thing that I would change about this movie. I think it's so wonderfully self-contained and really does a lot of things right that I'll talk when we get into the later movies about the decisions that they make that I think kind of go back on what this movie did so well. But I absolutely think this movie is phenomenal.
I'm going to also recommend this film pretty much for the reasons Mike just laid out. Like, it's a flawless movie and it does exactly what it sets out to do, but it does it in a surprising way. I think if you were just to tell somebody the basic premise of this film, hey, you've never seen The Terminator, it's about this killer robot that comes back from the future. You'd be like, that'd be kind of almost be a hard sell, I think, to some people. But when you watch it, you realize just on a technical level, on an emotional level, just how damn good this movie is. So yes, this is a 100% recommend for me as well. Mike, if people want to follow you on social media?
You can follow me at Hibachi Justice on Twitter. You can also follow me at Hibachi Justice on Letterboxd. For those that listen to us on the 20th Century Movie Club, that's where you'll find our list of movies we recommended on that. We probably won't at any point now be recommending any Terminator movies just because we're going to do a whole deep dive on them here. But assume that this one would be on the 20th Century Movie Club list as well, because damn, this movie's amazing.
Kind of surprised that it didn't make the list between you and I with 150 movies we've got on there so far. I'm actually surprised it never made the list.
I think part of it is we kind of had a hunch. You know, we had first talked about doing this a while ago, and I know I kind of held off on it because I wanted us to do a deeper dive because I think this series does warrant spending some more time talking about it, just given how all over the map it is.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I agree with you on that one about all over the map. All right. So if you want to follow the show on social media, you can do so on Twitter at Dana Buckler Show. You can follow the show on Instagram at The Dana Buckler Show. You can follow me on Instagram at The Real Dana Buckler. You can follow me on Twitter at Dana Buckler. You can go to the website, thedanabucklershow.com, and you can always email us with questions or comments at thedanabucklershow@gmail.com. All right. So Mike, we're going to pick this up again really soon. Thanks for being on the show, and we'll certainly talk soon.
Happy to be here. Thanks, buddy.
Absolutely. And my name is Dana Buckler, and thank you so much for listening.